Good afternoon and welcome. We have a full house today. Can you hear me in the back? Is the sound okay? Good. I'm Nadia Malek, chairman of Off the Record. On behalf of the Board of Governors of OTR and the Foreign Policy Association, I'd like to welcome you to the Elizabeth French Hitchcock Lecture, or as we have grown accustomed to calling it, the Hitchcock, an endowed lecture in honor of the memory of OTR's fourth chairman. The delivery of the Hitchcock is a distinction that we extend to notable thought leaders who play an influential role in shaping the discourse and how we look at the world. And we're delighted to have you here with us today, Fareed. I would also like to extend a special warm welcome to the cadets from West Point who are here with us today. Thank you for your commitment to serve. Just a few house rules before we begin. As a reminder, please turn off cell phones and all devices. Once Dr. Zakaria has finished his remarks, he will respond to your questions. During Q&A, please wait for a microphone to be brought to you before asking your brief question. We will end promptly at 2 p.m. And now I'd like to introduce Celeste Ford, my colleague and OTR governor, who will be introducing our speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Nadia. Let me start by telling you something that you might not already know about our speaker. Fareed Zakaria is a great immigrant. Several years ago, Carnegie Corporation of New York, the philanthropic foundation, named him a great immigrant as part of its annual tribute to naturalized citizens. I work for the foundation, and earlier this year, we wanted to highlight a few of our most respected honorees. We reviewed more than 400 outstanding immigrants from the past 10 years, many of them very famous and successful, and selected Fareed for this special initiative. Through his intellect and authentic international perspectives, he has elevated foreign and domestic policy discussion in this country as few others have. Fareed was born in India and earned degrees from Yale and Harvard before starting at Foreign Affairs as the magazine's managing editor. He went on to become the editor of Newsweek International and a columnist for Newsweek, an analyst and Sunday morning commentator for ABC News, and the host of his own PBS program. All this while writing best-selling books and parenting three children. Today, Fareed is the host of CNN's flagship international foreign affairs program, Fareed Zakaria GPS, an editor at large and a columnist for Time Magazine, and a columnist for The Washington Post. In short, he is a true oxymoron, best described as a rock star policy wonk. Let's give Fareed a warm welcome.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It's a huge pleasure to be here. It's a real honor. I've had the honor and privilege of being able to address the OTR before and have a long association with the Foreign Policy Association, so two of my favorite groups. I'm just delighted to be able to be here. I thought what I'd do is talk a little bit about what is going on in the United States these days. There's a little bit of news, as some of you might have noticed. In fact, I'm surprised that you're all here, because instead you could be staying home, turning on the television, and watching the greatest reality show in the history of American politics, which is this election. It's certainly been the most exciting and entertaining election I think any of us have ever been part of. Though it has become more and more shocking, right? I mean, it's funny. You look back on campaigns and the early moments of a president, and you always, you know, what stays in history, interestingly, are the words. You remember Franklin Roosevelt's words, you have nothing to fear but fear itself. You remember John F. Kennedy's words, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. What do you think we'll remember from this campaign, you know? Will it be that memorable moment when Marco Rubio accused Donald Trump of having a small penis? Will it be the moment that Donald Trump was deeply indignant about that, not because he thought it was vulgar and an outrage, but because he pointed out it was factually incorrect, that there is, in his memorable words that maybe will live in history, there is no problem down there. He really said this. Of course, now this looks bad. We look back on those innocent days compared to the campaign of the last month or two. I mean, if only we could return to those childlike moments when all that was going on was sexual innuendo. I think that what is striking to me, though, there's one other aspect of the campaign that I have to tell you. I found the most amusing commentary on the Democratic side, which was always less entertaining and interesting than the Republican side, was a line from Bill Maher, the comedian. So you remember there was this moment when Hillary and Sanders were neck to neck, and it did seem as though Sanders was gaining ground. And Bill Maher looks up at the camera and he says, "You know, Hillary, what can I tell you? We are trying to make this easy. The last time around, we ran you against a black guy with the name Barack Hussein Obama, whose grandfather was a Kenyan Muslim. This time, we're running you against a 74-year-old socialist Jew. What do we need to do to make this easier for you?" But as I say, always less entertaining on the Democratic side. But really, you know, when I look at it, what is striking, jokes aside, about this campaign is just how sad it is that America is so pessimistic, how sad it is that America is so anxious, how sad it is that America has become so fearful. And I say this as an immigrant. That introduction was so sweet to point that out, but that is something that I think I've come to realize more and more in my life, that I bring that perspective to a lot of the way I look at the world and the way I look at America, because I grew up in the 1960s and 70s in India. And, you know, India is a very, very poor country then. It still is a poor country, but has done much better. And the 70s were a terrible time in India. Stagflation, 40% inflation rates, 2 years of martial law. And for all of us young people in cities, America was the place that the future was being invented. It was the shining country on the hill. It was this place where everything seemed possible. And I still remember, you know, there was this fascination with all things American, because America was modernity. And of course, it was the only whatever we could snatch of America, we would consume. So when I was growing up in India, there was no television. This is something my children always point out to me when I try to get them to read. They're always, you know, and I'm always telling them, "Well, at your age, I was reading this, that, and the other." And they say, "Daddy, at your age, you didn't have anything else to do." There was like, you know, they felt like I was primitive, deprived Neanderthal in a cave with a bunch of books. But it's true. I was 10 years old when television comes to India, one channel, black and white, 4 hours a day, and most of it was documentaries extolling the glories of Indian agriculture. So I didn't tend to watch it. On Sundays, we had one Bollywood movie, and then it was preceded by the 130 minutes of imported entertainment that India could afford at the time. This is in 1977, which was old episodes of I Love Lucy from the 1950s. So we all loved it, and that to us was America. Then we start getting real contemporaneous stuff because of the videotape revolution. So all of a sudden we start getting these videotapes from America. I should point out, all entirely illegal and pirated. So what would happen is some Indian family in probably Edison, New Jersey, would tape record their favorite television show, and then it would get sent over to Bombay or Delhi. And these Betamax cassettes were passed around to families in India, like, you know, the Samizdat literature of the Soviet era, where, you know, people would quietly and furtively be giving each other copies of George Orwell's 1984. Well, we would get American sitcoms in the same way and, you know, pass around copies of Three's Company and things like that. And I remember the thing that defined America for me. Every immigrant has a story about their sort of version of the American dream, the thing that attracted them about America initially. And I'd like to say it was, you know, my deep reading of America. It was Fitzgerald and Hemingway, but really it was the opening credits to Dallas. I don't know how many of you remember that CBS miniseries, but it's this incredible montage of you know, these images of Dallas, the glass skyscrapers, these helicopters landing on and off the buildings, these enormous ranches, the Cadillac cars that, you know, the men were getting into with 10-gallon hats and these, you know, leather briefcases. And then, of course, the women. Yes, you know, Victoria Principal was definitely part of my American dream. For the cadets in the audience, Google her, trust me. I think that the thing that most struck me about that, you know, despite everything I described, was just the energy, the dynamism, that sense of optimism which contrasted, which was a sharp color contrast, if you will, to the pale black and white documentaries of Indian villages. And that difference is what the world has always seen in America, the sense of the future. When I got to America, Ronald Reagan was president, and I remember Reagan had one this great line where he said, "Americans are not interested in your origins, they're interested in your destination." And there was always a sense that that was what America was about. It was looking forward, it was not looking back. And to see this same country in a situation where it is fearful, where it is anxious, where it is really worried about the past, losing its past, losing something, rather than thinking expectantly about what it can gain, what is around the next corner, that's been the biggest challenge and surprise for me. And I think about why it is, and I'm struck by this fact that, you know, the America I came to was locked in a deadly, mortal combat with the Soviet Union, geopolitically, geoeconomically, and it was traumatizing not just the United States, but the world. I mean, if you think about what the world looked like in the 1980s, there were 18 different wars taking place around the world where the Soviet Union was funding, arming, supporting some group, an insurgent group or a government that was engaged in violent, you know, military action of some kind or the other. And the United States was funding the other side of every one of those 18 conflicts. And that reality of a world in which you had these deep political divides was spilled over into every continent. You had these kind of wars slash civil wars slash insurgencies going on in Central America and Latin America. You had them going on in Africa. You had them going on in Southeast Asia. You had them going on in Asia in general. And it wasn't just geopolitics, it was economics. The world was divided between, frankly, a very small club of free economies, free trading economies, open market economies, the United States, Canada, 15 countries in Europe, 4 countries in Asia, that was it. Everybody else was part of a closed, quasi-socialist world. And that was the reality of the world I grew up in, that was the world I, you know, was part of when I first came to America. And then all this begins to change, right? The Soviet Union collapses, communism is destroyed, socialism is discredited, and the whole world starts to come together. Everybody starts to try to play by the same rules, be part of the same global system, be part of the same global economy. And that process begins and accelerates in the 1990s. And so all of a sudden you end up in a situation where countries that had long been seen as bastions of pro-Soviet, socialist, anti-Americanism start moving into a single global system where they are not in opposition, ideological, political, economic, to the existing world order, but are integrating into it. The most dramatic of those changes, of course, being China, but it is happening really everywhere. If you think about Latin America in the 1970s, a continent entirely ruled by juntas, consumed by anti-Americanism, riven by insurgencies, civil wars, and wars. And you think of the Latin America of today, which is a continent that is almost entirely democratic, with the exception of Cuba and partially Venezuela, a continent with no military rulers, with many, many governments that are pro-trade, pro-West, pro-markets, pro-reform. It's a striking shift. So in a sense, you had this enormous, this extraordinary shift towards political stability. Those 18 civil wars I mentioned all started to wind down and all started to, in a sense, dissipate to the point where they have almost entirely disappeared by now. Economically, you started to have a kind of convergence where everyone was playing the same game. And technologically, the world starts to come together as you have the invention and as you have the acceleration of a technological revolution called the information revolution. So it's, you know, three different great tsunamis: political stability, economic convergence, and technological connectivity start pushing the world together into one great, fast-moving, fast-paced global system. And you can see the interactions in, you know, different places in different ways. But look at, for example, just the technological transformation, the information revolution. So in 1990, Saddam Hussein invades Kuwait. Many of you remember that. When he invades Kuwait, the country that was freaked out most by this was, of course, Saudi Arabia, because Saudi Arabia is right next door to Kuwait. And so the Saudis are trying to figure out, well, what does it mean if Saddam Hussein is going after Kuwait for the oil? If those tanks just keep driving, they'll get to Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is the mother lode of oil in the world. And so they're trying to decide, do we ask the Americans to help us? Do we ask the Americans to protect us? It's a difficult problem. It's a conservative society, conservative regime, conservative monarchy, and the king is 85 years old. The king in Saudi Arabia, by the way, is always 85 years old. You know, it's, I mean, I don't know, they had this succession system where when the king died, his next oldest brother would become the king, and there were 66 of them. So by the time it was your turn, you could write it in the constitution, you were going to be 85 years old. Now there's, you know, the king has done something very bold and transforming, and completely disrupted the whole system by appointing a 67-year-old as the crown prince. And then there is a deputy crown prince who's actually 30. But the king right now is 87, in case you were wondering. So the king decides, I'm going to just take some time to try to figure it out. And so I don't want to tell anyone that that Saddam Hussein has invaded Kuwait. So just to give me some time, let's not announce that our next door neighbor was invaded by Iraq. And for one week, it was a Saudi state secret that Kuwait had been invaded by Iraq, and it held. Now ask yourself, in today's world, that was 1990. In today's world, how long would such a state secret hold, even in Saudi Arabia? You know, 1 minute, right? You've got BBC, you've got CNN, you've got Al Jazeera, you've got Al Arabiya, you've got websites that would start publishing it. You have just phones, which are powerful enough to transmit anything now, right? Twitter is this thing which is originally set up, and you were meant to answer the question, what are you doing right now? And you had to answer it in 140 characters. And so all you needed was some guy in Kuwait to tweet, I'm being invaded by Iraq, right? And that would be the end of the Saudi state secret. But think about this. The control of information has always been at the heart of the power of governments. So the ability to control, if you look back in the 1930s, when you'd have coups, the two things would happen. The coup plotters would go to the presidential palace and arrest or kill the president, and then go to the radio station and take over, because they wanted the one place where you could broadcast information to many people, a one-to-many system. By the 60s, they were taking over the presidential palace and the TV station. Same idea. Today, if you take over, if you want to do a coup, okay, you get the president, but then what do? How do you control information? We actually saw this play out in Turkey, where they tried to go after the president. They kind of failed, so strike one. But more importantly, they tried to go after the sources of information. So they were trying to, clearly perplexed by how to do this, they decided to go after the most well-known station they could think of in Istanbul, which was CNN Turk. They go after it, they kind of take it over, and the president, who is at this point now stranded in an airport somewhere, decides to broadcast to the nation using his iPhone. And he literally is able to broadcast a message to the nation using an iPhone, and then the nation rallies to support him. Because the news system is not a one-to-many, but a many-to-many, where every node in the system is as powerful as, you know, any television station or radio station from the past. And that's the shift that's taken place, and that is what has weakened dramatically the power of these kinds of big institutions, particularly something like a government. So that's just one illustration of this extraordinary shift that's taken place. Now, if you look at the world that I've described, it has become richer, it has become more inclusive, it has become more diverse and more varied. The number of countries that are growing faster today is much, much higher than were in the 1960s and 70s. The best data I can give you is 1979, the number of countries growing at 3% a year was about 30, 35 countries. Today, even today, after the financial crisis, it is something closer to 60 or 65 countries. In 2007, it was 124 countries. And so you have the reality of this political stability, this economic convergence, this technological connectivity, producing extraordinary global growth. But was it done for the United States? Well, look at the United States today. The United States dominates the world in every leading technology of the future. If you were to ask yourself in the 1970s and the 1980s, what country dominates the technologies of the future? Well, you know, look at the 70s or 80s even. You would have been talking about cars, consumer electronics, things like that. You'd have certainly talked about America. You'd have talked about Germany, Japan. You'd have talked about even the Dutch. Think about Philips, companies like that. Today, when you look at technologies of the future, by which I mean the great technologies of the digital world, they're all American. Germany is this much vaunted economy that everyone talks about. It does not have a single company in this whole space. Google has a 65% market share in the United States. It has a 95% market share in Europe. There are 8 global platforms in the world that are internet platforms, which are essentially becoming the platforms on which all of life happens, from Amazon to Microsoft Outlook to Facebook to Snapchat to YouTube. All of them are American. Think about that. 8 global platforms that are used by more than 1 billion people each, all of them American. But then if you look at the world of nanotechnology, biotechnology, in almost all of these areas, America dominates or has huge leads. If you look at demography, the United States is the only advanced industrial country of any size that is actually vibrant and growing demographically. Why is this important? Well, because if your fate is what every other rich country in the world faces, and you are in a downward spiral where you are literally you face the prospect of shrinking your population, you are in a slow death spiral. If you look at Japan right now, 32,000 people in Japan turned 100 this year. Do you know how many people were in Japan who were 100 already? How many centenarians there were? 32,000. In other words, they are rapidly aging. And why is this important? First of all, you need workers. You need workers to pay taxes, to support the pensions and healthcare of elderly people. But more importantly, you need workers to be young, dynamic, hardworking, and productive. I saw a study which pointed out that in the Nobel Prize winners in science, 95% of the Nobel Prize winners in science, this is over the last 100 years, had done the work for which they got the Nobel Prize before they were 45 years old. Because it is when you're young that you are willing to question authority, break with tradition, forge your own path, start your own company, try and do something risky intellectually, artistically. Bob Dylan got the Nobel Prize for work that surely we would all agree he did probably before he was 30 years old, right? That is when society, you know, you demonstrate that ability to forge new paths. And if you have, on the other hand, a society of retirees, you are going to have a different profile in terms of growth, entrepreneurship, and enterprise. You look at Italy. Italy is in 5 years going to look like Florida. Now, I should say, I don't mean this aesthetically. The Italians would be horrified at the prospect that they look like Florida. I'm just back from Piedmont. I can promise you it does not look anything like Florida. I mean, demographically, it is going to look like Florida. It is going to be a retirement state. And you cannot grow in those circumstances. And each of these countries faces those same problems. But the United States does not, largely because it takes in about 1 million legal immigrants every year, and that reality provides this kind of infusion of dynamism and energy to the United States. Take energy. Everywhere else in the world, they face enormous problems in terms of the acquisition and deployment of energy. The United States has had a transformation of that. 20 years ago, the United States had produced 1 million barrels of oil. Now we produce 9 million. This year, the United States will be the largest producer of liquid hydrocarbons in the world, more than Saudi Arabia, more than Russia. It is a completely transformed energy reality for the United States, and it has begun to dominate the new technologies of the future, like solar and wind. And then finally, I would point out, and now you're going to think I'm truly Pollyannish, American government actually works pretty well. Now, what do I mean by that? If you think for a moment that I'm going to defend Washington, you're wrong. I'm not that stupid. The point I'd make is most government, Tocqueville saw this in 1832, most government in America happens at the local level. And at the local level, mayors, governors, city councils, government is actually working quite well. Mayors are by and large bipartisan. They are reaching across party lines. They work with the private sector. They make investments. And they are actually much more competent than the mayors were 30 or 40 years ago. Cities were 40 years ago run as a combination of kind of patronage operations, deeply corrupt, highly ineffective, often with huge union participation and domination, and often with people who had rather unworkable, very idealistic, some would say crazy left-wing ideas, right? Though that was the reality of unions, of cities in the 1960s. Today, if you look at Bloomberg when he was in New York, Rahm Emanuel in Chicago, Garcetti in LA, you look at cities from Nashville, Houston, Denver, all of them you see something very different. Mayors who are trying to run their cities on a kind of best practices basis, in general, much more enlightened, much more management oriented than before. James Fallows, this wonderful journalist, took a little plane and traveled around America. And he found that it was really interesting. He'd go to smaller cities and towns, and he'd ask people, what do you think is going on in America? And they'd say, oh, it's terrible. The country's going to hell. And he'd say, okay, how are things in Sioux Falls? And they'd say, oh, great. Things are actually wonderful here. We're reviving the economy. We're investing in education. We're welcoming our immigrants. And he found that pattern again and again. America in the abstract was terrible, but their communities in the particular were wonderful. And so there was some disconnect here that I think we are unable to completely fathom. Now, having said all that, there is clearly a deep discontent in the United States. And I would argue, and I want to just telegraph some of this very quickly because I want to get to questions, that if you want to try to understand this wave of populism that has been coursing through the Western economies, let's try to understand it systemically and not by looking at one country in particular. We do have Donald Trump. But Trump, despite what he may think, is not unique. There are Trumps everywhere. If you look across Western Europe, you see them. In France, in Germany, in Northern Europe, in Southern Europe. And what's striking is, you think to yourself, well, this is all economic anxiety, right? Wrong, because Sweden is doing very well. Holland is doing very well. Denmark is doing very well. And yet they have these right-wing populist movements. And then you think, well, it's all about populism on the left and right. Not really, because the truth is the left-wing populism is of a very different nature. It is an entirely understandable reaction to two things that happened over the last 20 years. The first is that almost every left-wing party in the world, certainly in the West, moved right. Think about Bill Clinton with the Democratic Party, Tony Blair with the Labour Party, and that same phenomenon took place everywhere. The second is the great financial crisis and recession. So those two things opened up a space on the left which has been filled by left-wing populist parties. But by the way, even those parties are much less left-wing than left-wing parties were 30 years ago. So Greece has this party called Syriza. And people say, oh my God, this crazy left-wing party that is now in power, busily implementing the German austerity program that their predecessors were implementing. Compare them to PASOK, which was the main Greek party in the 1970s, whose platform reads like something out of a socialist manifesto, nationalizing vast swaths of the industry, taxes at the rates of 70 and 90%, regulations on everything. Very, very difficult to find any party that proposes what every social democratic party in the 1970s was proposing. The right-wing populism is what is new. And as I say, does not seem to be entirely about economics, because countries that are growing have it, countries that are shrinking have it, countries in the middle have it. So what is going on? What is the distinctive feature that we notice about the modern Western world? Because it's not happening in Asia. It's not happening in Latin America even. So what's happening in Western Europe and America that's different? And there's one thing, immigration. Right? That is the one thing that is common to this set of countries. And it's real. And that's why I think it's important to understand what you have is these societies in which people feel that their countries are changing. And they are right. And they are changing because, in large part, of immigration. Immigration is, in a sense, the fourth frontier of globalization. You have had the globalization of goods with the invention of tall ships. You have had the globalization of capital with the invention of large banks in the 19th century. You have had the globalization of services in the 20th century, particularly in the late 20th century with the invention of information technology. And now you have the globalization of people. But it turns out those first three were all abstractions. People are real, and they look different, and they sound different, and they worship different gods, and they have different cultural traditions. And when people see that, it causes a very strong, powerful reaction. And it says to them, my country is not the same again. And that, it strikes me, is at the heart of not just the Trump phenomenon, but the phenomenon, the related phenomenons you see across Western Europe. And it's real, and it's powerful, and it's something we are all going to have to deal with. And it is something we're going to have to figure out how we get around it. By which I mean to say, we're going to have to find ways to make our societies more comfortable with this reality. In 1970, 4% of America was foreign-born. Today, 15% of America is foreign-born. So there is a reality here. That number, by the way, that shift is even greater in Europe. And so that becomes, I think that is the beginning of the conversation we need to have. And I leave you with one final optimistic thought, which is, we'll get through this. And the reason I think we'll get through it is, at the end of the day, the people in this country who are most welcoming of all these changes, all these transformations, and particularly of the fact that they live in a diverse society and they benefit from a diverse society, are young people. If you look at the poll numbers and you see how young people feel about the diversity of their countries, they view it as a benefit economically, politically, culturally, and personally. They want to live in a connected world. They can't imagine being locked out, building walls, and banning people. And so at the end of the day, I think we will get through this final, very rough phase of globalization and all the upheavals it produces. And we'll get through it because, particularly in this country, we have lots of bright, idealistic young people who have a desire for a new, diverse, and interconnected future. We just have to make sure we don't blow up the country while we're getting to that future. Thank you all very much. Thank you. All right, questions? Nadia.
I don't know. There we go. Thank you, Fareed. At this time, we can jump into Q&A. Please wait for a microphone to be brought to you before asking your brief question.
I can't see the mics, and so I'm going to have to, hope that, Ma'am, yes.
Hi. How would you compare the immigration situation in the teens and early 20s to the situation now?
It's a great question. So how does the situation in the teens and early 20s look like in immigration compared to now? So in the United States, I pointed out that it's 1970, we were at 4%, we were about 4.5%, we're now at about 14.5% to be exact. And that sounds a dramatic rise. And it is from roughly 1930 to 1970, immigration in the United States had stayed at about 4-5%, that is 4-5% foreign-born. But before that, the United States had much higher levels of foreign-born people. In fact, probably higher than we even have now. The documented numbers are in the 15-16% range. So the truth is the United States has had large influxes of immigration, legal and illegal. And by the way, before the 1920s, there was very little distinction. If you made your way here and you weren't diseased, you were legal, right? And so the reality was we were always dealing with it. But, and just again to remind one about history, it did produce a lot of turmoil. It did produce an awful lot of anti-immigrant feeling. It produced nativists, it produced nationalists. Indeed, it produced the legislation that capped immigration at the levels it did. And it capped them at levels that were essentially meant to preserve white supremacy, to put it very simply. It was meant to be from historic countries that had historically sent immigrants to the United States, which was essentially meant to mean Western Europe. But if you go even further back than that, what you find is, this is a very interesting historical parallel, the Whig Party was one of these great parties in America that is destroyed in the 1920s and 30s. And why is it destroyed? Because it splits on slavery. It splits right down the middle. But at the same time, there is rising a new party called the Know-Nothings. And the Know-Nothings rise because they are unalterably opposed to immigration. Mostly Irish immigration, but mass uncontrolled immigration. And they become very powerful. And that parallel seems to me very interesting for today. I should point out that while I would love to tell you that the Know-Nothings are called the Know-Nothings because they knew nothing, it was because they were meant to be a secret party. And when you asked them, who they were, what they stood for, the party members were meant to say, "I know nothing." And so that's where the term comes from. I'm just starting at the front. Don't worry, we'll move around. The great thing about this group is sometimes you always worry about making sure there are enough women asking questions. I don't think that will be a problem with this group.
Thank you so much. You have been talking about parallelism between Europe and the US. You have talked about populism and also about phenomenon here like Trump, but also I think it's very interesting to have a look at Bernie Sanders. Of course, I understand the importance and relevance of immigration and the problems and challenges that it's causing. But I wanted to ask you that maybe since the financial crisis, we are not going through a financial problem, but also that maybe we are going also through a political transformation. And I wanted to ask you whether this last few years, both in Europe and now the European Union, which is under a lot of trouble, but also here in the U.S., if maybe what's happening
differently.
I guess people just want to know what your question
is. So I'm talking about a deeper concern, which should be a political transformation or even political crisis, which maybe has opened with the economic or financial crisis, and if maybe we should revitalize democracy, make it closer to citizens, and sorry. Maybe I think you understood me, right?
Yeah, so okay. Let me try and characterize.
Yeah, I'm trying to go deeper into.
So I think the question was: Are there deeper roots to this to the sort of anger that lie perhaps in the financial crisis, and I think that by implication the economics. I guess the way I look at it, you know, we do have very difficult economic times. There's this rise of inequality that is real. There is a slowdown in productivity. There is a slow recovery. But you know, I don't know when we had this glorious past that people all look back to with great nostalgia. Was it the 1970s when you had the so-called misery index at 25%? This was a combination of inflation and unemployment. Was it the 1960s when you had Jim Crow, Vietnam, and the civil rights movement with cities exploding in crime? Remember in 1968, you had 115 cities literally explode with race riots and crime? Was it the 1940s when you had World War II? Was it the 1930s when you had the Great Depression? Was it the 1870s and 90s when you had the worst agricultural recessions in the world? I mean, what is this period that we all look back on with this great fondness? And who is the we? I sometimes think, you know, when we think about the 1950s, these great, you know, halcyon days of the Eisenhower world, well, you know, just let's keep in mind that for a woman in America, you couldn't be a lawyer in most states, you couldn't be a doctor in most states, you certainly couldn't get promoted beyond much more than a secretary. And I haven't even talked about what life was like for black people, right? So who's the we? Sometimes one wonders when you hear about how much better it was in those days. Look, we face challenges, and that's why I'm not as convinced that these particular economic challenges are at the core of what's going on, because we've always faced a different set of economic challenges. Right now, the way I describe it is we face real problems in terms of getting the wages of the median person, average people, up. And you know why. There's globalization on the one hand, there's technology on the other. On the other hand, we have a world of extraordinary abundance and technological prowess and connectivity. People have this extraordinary ability to consume and use information and technology mostly for free in a way that they never could before. I mean, the iPhones that you have in your pocket, or some of you are furtively looking at even while pretending to listen to me, are more powerful than the NASA computers that took man to the moon and back times 100. So what you have in your pocket, when I came to America, there were three Cray supercomputers. The government owned all three of them. And they were the three most powerful computers in the world. The iPhone 6 is more powerful than the Cray supercomputers. So think about that kind of computing power that is at the fingertips of every person. There are some challenges, there are some opportunities, but as I say, what strikes me as different about the world we're living in is this issue of people, of migration, of race. Economic problems we've always had. They've had different ones and different stages. The European Union, again, we can have a long discussion about its benefits and its drawbacks. It has expanded the market in Europe dramatically. It made one incredibly stupid mistake of having the euro, which is an act of hubris that they are paying a price for. But it doesn't feel to me like, you know, is Europe's economic situation really much worse than it was 30 years ago, 50 years ago, 70 years ago? No. What's different? You have to always, in social science, ask yourself, if you're trying to explain something, you got to look for something that has varied. You know, what's the shift now? What's happening now that wasn't happening before? It's not economic instability, economic crisis. They've always been there. What's shifted is this extraordinary influx of people into every European country.
I'm going to put the West Point cadets on the spot. You have to have a question. Where are you all? Okay. Right there.
Yeah. Nadia, if you can identify people, there's a light shining directly in my eyes, and so I can't actually.
Sir, thank you. Sir, thank you for that talk. I thought that was really great. Thanks, FPA and OTR, for having us. At the beginning, you talked about this long-term optimism and kind of this short-term pessimism that I think a lot of us in this room have. But my question is, whoever wins in a week from now, what is the one thing that the pessimists are going to look to for them to step their game up and help fix? I mean, what is the one quality that they can use to change the pessimist's mind?
Gosh, that's a tough.
In terms of a kind of recovery standpoint, how are they going to help us psychologically recover from what has happened in the past couple of months? Thank you.
It's a very good question, because I think that it gets at one of the big changes that I think has happened in American politics, which is that it used to be possible for people to have very strong and sharp disagreements. But because those disagreements were fundamentally about policy, it was possible to get together after an election and say, okay, this is my view, this is your view, let's split the difference. But over the last 25 years, there has developed this idea that the other side is not just your political, doesn't just disagree with you politically, but is morally, personally corrupt, degraded, and in many ways criminal. You know, this is one of the great tragic legacies of Watergate, which was a genuine, Watergate was a genuine case of a president engaging in high crimes and misdemeanors. Ever since then, it has become something of a bizarre caricature of Watergate, where every time you have a big policy disagreement, everybody lawyers up six, inquiries and subpoenas at each other and tries to prove that the other person deserves to be in jail. This began actually with after Watergate with the Reagan administration, when a Democratic Congress decided they were going to take Iran-Contra, which was essentially an argument, a disagreement over public policy, in my view, and turned it into one with a special prosecutor, independent counsel, millions of dollars spent, and at the end of the day, very little accomplished other than utterly poisoning the atmosphere. The Clinton administration, of course, was a crescendo of this kind of witch hunts, where almost every cabinet officer at some point had a special prosecutor investigating him. And understand, when you have special prosecutors or prosecutors trained on you, this reverses the principle of Anglo-Saxon law. The point is meant to be there is a crime, and then you investigate who did it, not there is a person, and then you try to figure out whether that person has in some way committed a crime. As Warren Buffett says, if a policeman tails you for 500 miles, you will get a ticket, right? We've all done something that we can be found guilty of. The FBI could be investigating 1,000 crimes a minute. What it chooses to investigate becomes, an issue of selection. And so we've gotten to this point now where politics has become a blood sport. It's a life and death game. And in that context, at the end of the election, it's very difficult to compromise and say, hey, let's all build that bridge together, right? And that's the problem. What can the pessimists do? So, to my mind, there's a kind of dark pessimism that has developed. And I have to be honest, particularly on the right. Newt Gingrich began it in the 1990s when he developed this idea that the way the Republican Party was going to win was to say that the Democrats were, and this is all, written out in internal memos, were degenerate, immoral, were destroying the country. What the country needed was a revolution. This is language, frankly, redolent of a kind of third world banana republic. It's not what you would normally see in a democracy. And so that has produced, and it's obviously produced a reaction on the left as well, it's produced a circumstance where it's very difficult to compromise. It's very difficult to be the guy who says, yeah, I may, remember that guy you were calling the devil and who isn't even an American and who deserves to be in jail? I just made a deal with him. That's tough. So I would like to tell you that from the pessimism can come some good, but I think we're in a very dark place with that pessimism. The way in which pessimism is always productive is it makes you anxious and worried in a productive, competitive sense. You all know it at West Point, which is if you think you're down, you will work harder, whether in a game, whether in a class. You know, that sense of being behind can be a spur to action. I think it's very helpful in capitalism. It's very helpful in sports. But, you know, what I worry about sometimes is that there's one thing to run hard. It's another thing to run scared. And I don't want us as a country to run scared. There are a lot of things in this country to be very proud of and optimistic about. Of course, we should run harder, but we shouldn't run scared.
If Donald Trump was elected, would fear among Americans be justified, and why?
If Donald Trump were elected, would the fear among some Americans, I should say, be justified? Look, yes, in my view, Trump is not an ordinary political candidate. Trump is somebody who has, you know, done a number of things that are very worrying and should be very worrying to any American. The first are the set of policy positions that he has taken, which are really borderline unconstitutional and I would argue deeply un-American. You know, whether it is the building of a wall, the branding of all Mexican immigrants the way he did as rapists and murderers, whether it is the call for a ban on one particular religion, Muslims, which is almost certainly in some form unconstitutional. Most obviously, it is pretty unworkable, right? Imagine the guy at the immigration counter asking the ISIS supporter who's trying to sneak into the country, "Are you a Muslim?" What do you think the ISIS guy, is going to say, right? It doesn't strike me as a very intelligent idea, outside of the fact that it's deeply unconstitutional. To the kinds of things he said about being willing to engage in, and readily acknowledge that he'd be willing to engage in things that the U.S. Army, in its own code book, defines as war crimes. It would raise profound questions for people in the Army. Do you follow orders that you know are unconstitutional? There are several generals, as you know, who have said that if a military officer were asked to do something that he or she knew was a war crime, they would not do it. The very fact that we're having that set of conversations tells you how deeply troubling it is that Trump is articulating these positions. The second is an extraordinarily cavalier understanding of the power of the presidency. So Trump has said that he would like to change libel laws so that he could sue newspapers and magazines and TV stations who write nasty things about him. Without, first of all, understanding that the president doesn't change libel laws. These are interpretations of the First Amendment that the Supreme Court provides. It's not like he could do it. He's talked about how he's had rich people who've given money to his political opponents in the primary, and he said, you know, I would look into them very seriously, echoing something only Richard Nixon has done, which is use the powers of government to go after people he regarded as political opponents. As you know, he's talked about appointing a special prosecutor to go after Hillary Clinton and lock her up, which strikes me as almost the epitome of a kind of third world banana republic, where the goal is not to defeat your opponent, but to lock her up. I think that all of that, you put it all together, this is not a normal political candidate. I mean, there is a reason that there are five living Republican nominees for president. Okay, there are five living Republican nominees for president. Four of them are not going to vote for Donald Trump, right? That's Romney, McCain, Bush. Only the 93-year-old Robert Dole, as far as I can tell, plans to vote for Donald Trump. That should tell us something. For anyone who is a Republican and independent, if five of your party's nominees, if four of the five of your party's nominees feel that this person is so unqualified that they would probably for the first time in their lives break ranks and not vote, there's something going on here.
Right, and like to know is if we have done so well in terms of economic benefits from free trade agreements and with international trade, why should we be optimistic about our economic future if both presidential candidates are now closing off their any idea of any more free trade agreements, and Donald Trump is in fact saying that he's going to abrogate NAFTA?
It's a very good question. Look, it's unfortunate because we have gotten ourselves into a situation where we are large economies with very high per capita incomes. Which, you know, the United States per capita income is now over $50,000. To give you a sense of where that compares, even in today's dollars, in 1900, average per capita GDP in America, I think, was about 8,000, and we were the richest country in the world even then. And so it's an extraordinary rise in income that has taken place, and a large part of it is because the United States has been open. It has been open to ideas, people, goods, services. It's difficult to think of many ways to boost the growth rates of very rich established countries, right? There's, you know, much as I would like to build more infrastructure, and I do think we should, you're not going to get that much of a bang for the buck, right? You've already connected the whole country. It's not like China or India, where you're building a new road between two towns that have never had roads before. So it's very difficult to look at things that are going to boost growth. Trade is the one thing that we know boosts growth. Largely, this is the irony of it because of the Republican opposition, because it lowers taxes. We call them tariffs, but the point is, when you're doing it internationally, what you're doing is lowering the price consumers have to pay to buy and sell stuff, and that tends to increase economic activity. It's a principle that most conservatives have usually well understood, except when it comes to trade, then, you know, they now have second thoughts. But why, to your very good question, should one still be optimistic? Because the large bulk of tariff reductions has already happened. The world we live in, tariffs on in the industrialized world are at around 3%. So you already live in a world of free trade. You can't turn that clock off. Much as Donald Trump might try, it's not really going to work. You slap tariffs on China, all that's going to happen is you're going to get the goods from Vietnam, or you're going to get the goods from Bangladesh. It's not as though all of a sudden you're going to start manufacturing this stuff in the United States. The reality is we have already transitioned to a service economy. We have already transitioned to a post-industrial economy, and we have to find growth out of that. We don't want to pay people a dollar a day to make sneakers. That is not going to raise American wages, right? And so we have to find ways to grow within this reality. It's difficult to see how you would really turn back the way that Trump is talking about if he has this image of really shutting ourselves off to all countries, you know, really erecting the kind of import barriers that, say, the India I grew up in had. I can tell him what will happen. You will end up with a slower growing, weak, dysfunctional economy which produces crappy products and shoddy goods and is unconnected and unaware with all the cutting edge leading force trends in the world. That's what happened to every country that tried to cut itself off from the world. So I don't think it's possible, and if it were to happen, it would be economically devastating, right? I mean, we would plunge into the worst recession since the Great Depression for sure. It's difficult to imagine the American people supporting it. And by the way, I should point out, there was a very good poll on this 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, from the Chicago Council on Foreign Relations. A majority of Americans support free trade. A majority of Democrats support free trade. The big shift in American politics is that the majority of Republicans who used to support free trade 2-1 20 years ago now oppose it 2-1. That is the big shift that has taken place. And that is why you see the parties resorting, where the Republican Party is becoming a party of non-college educated whites who are fearful of this new world, and the Democratic Party is becoming a party of urbanites, professionals, college-educated types, and minorities who are more embracing of this reality.
I'd like to squeeze in one more question from this young man right over here. Final question.
Hello. Hi, I had a question. In the Republican primary, Donald Trump got the most votes among minorities, Latinos, Muslims especially, et cetera, compared to other Republican candidates. And even in the polling so far, he seems to do well with Latinos, even compared to Romney in 2012. The rhetoric right now suggests that Trumpism is anti-immigration and he wouldn't appeal to minorities and only appeals to whites. Given his poll numbers, what do you make of his appeal to minorities, both in the primary and the general, compared to Romney?
You know, I guess first I would have to tell you, I don't think your information is accurate. Donald Trump did better among minorities with minorities than other Republican candidates, but you know, this much was made of this. I think it was in Nevada or Colorado, but I think I'm only being slightly facetious when I say of the 7 Latinos and who were registered Republicans, 4 voted for him. I think that for many people, when watching the third debate, if you remember, this was the town hall where there was one of the people who stood up, you know, and said, I'm a Muslim voter and I'm undecided. I think the great puzzle of that debate was that there was a Muslim undecided voter in the United States. So the numbers right now on Trump are, Obama got about 77% of the Asian and Latino vote. Hillary Clinton gets about 78-79% of the registered vote. What you're talking about is likely voters, and there's a slight drop-off there in some cases. But that it seems largely attributed to the fact that there was a particular enthusiasm for Obama which does not seem replicated. But to give you an understanding of what that means, she still, even in the bad polls, ends up with 75%. So it's not clear to me that that's enough of a gap that one can really understand it in terms of, you know, Trump is doing well among minorities. I think it's fair to say that there is some group of Latinos, particularly, that you know, despite what he said, his Latino polling is not at zero, which continues to amaze me. But it's largely, I think, because, understandably, there are some people who, you know, I mean, people have ideas and ideologies that are separate from their ethnic identity, which is, I think, wonderful and commendable. I think there are some Latinos who like the idea of a strong guy who will take charge. There are some people who like the personality, the celebrity in politics. There are some, frankly, who like the idea of an anti-immigrant. There is a long tradition of recent immigrants. There's a long history in the United States of recent immigrants who don't like the idea of immigration anymore. It's called pulling up the ladder after you, right? And that's hardly that, it's not that unusual. I think with blacks, you would really be straining the statistics, because I think that there are some polls in which Donald Trump does not register as getting black support, by which I mean to say that his support, which is in the 2-3 range, is within the margin of error of the poll. So it actually, it accounts to zero, and that is by far the worst any Republican candidate has ever gotten. The most striking thing about Trump, which is new, is women. I mean, Hillary Clinton has a 40-point advantage. That's with young people. She has a 25-point advantage with him over with women. But the really significant one is the young people. So if you look at voters under 35, Trump is actually polling 4th. He polls after Clinton, of course, but after Gary Johnson, and in some polls after Jill Stein. And so if you think to yourself, what is the future of the Republican Party if it adopts Trumpism going to look like? That's the part that is not just worrying for the Republican Party, because if the Republican Party transforms itself into a nationalist, populist, xenophobic party, not only is it going to lose minorities of all kinds, it's probably going to lose college-educated professionals, but it's losing young people at an alarming clip, and it's difficult to see how you are able to be the party of the future if you do that. But by the way, that's also going to be very bad for the country, because what is going to happen if the Republican Party keeps shrinking in the way it is by excluding these parts of America, is it is going to shrink more and more to a very small, angry base. So what is likely to happen on Tuesday? Whatever happens in the House of Representatives, and most likely the Republicans will retain their majority, but who's going to lose seats among the Republican Party? It's the moderates. It's the suburban Republicans. It's the Republicans who represent cities. They're all going to lose. Who's going to win? The rural South, the rural West. It is the people who are part of the Freedom Caucus, the Tea Party. So these people are going to be more intransigent, more obstructionist, more xenophobic, more angry, and as a result, you're going to have, you know, even more of this inability to compromise, inability to come together. This is what I worry about most, because, you know, at the end of the day, if we spend another 4 years in hearings and counter hearings and subpoenas and charges, I mean, it's going to make for great drama. It's going to be great for CNN, I can tell you. It's going to be terrible for the country, because we need to, we, you know, we do have actual problems. We do need infrastructure fixed. We need the healthcare system that operates. We need to deal with the immigration problem. We need to figure out how do we get these median incomes back up. And there, you know, most countries have all these problems and they have no solutions. The United States is unusual in that we have problems, but we have many solutions to these problems. We just can't seem to summon the political will to get them done. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.